To forgive means to live. It means to let go of the plague of unforgiveness. It means to be set free and experience life. What power there is in forgiveness. Let's go to the Lord right now in prayer. Father God, I ask you to send down the Holy Spirit. Let the Word of God become alive within us. Help us to experience the power of forgiveness, Lord God, and we'll give you the glory. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. You don't have to live very long before somebody does something to you to offend you. It's so easy for the hurt and the pain to continue to grow and grow. And as we hold it inside of us, it's going to cause us to become emotionally ill and bitter. But we let the healing of forgiveness take place. We can experience the power that comes with such a healing. Recently, I had an absentee landlord who has property right next door to where Deborah and I live. And that absentee landlord, he went spraying poison ivy on our fence line. And it actually got onto our flowers and destroyed them. And when he was asked about what chemical he used, he literally went ballistic. I mean, just really went off the wall. Got in his truck and took off. Well, as I began to think about that, I found myself praying for this particular neighbor. And as the grass grew bigger and bigger, I had the flesh one to say, hey, he's going to get a weed notice sooner or later. It's on him because he's too embarrassed, I think, to come back and actually mow his grass. And it got to be pretty good size, about that size. And then the Holy Spirit spoke to me. He said, Larry, mow that neighbor's yard. Why, Lord? He said, mow that neighbor's yard. So I went out there and I mowed the neighbor's yard. And when I did that, it just like a load just lifted from me. That's why Jesus said, pray for those who would despitefully use you and persecute you. Do good. If they ask you to go 1 mile, go 2. And what do we do? As we show love, it actually is putting coals of fire on those that, are holding all this bitterness inside. In fact, we could say that bitterness and unforgiveness is drinking the poison we think the other person's going to get. We're the ones that end up being the big loser. And mowing that neighbor's yard, well, it wasn't so revolutionary. It's actually quite biblical. The fact is, though, it sounds so unusual is because I'm not doing it as much as I should. And that's why I need to get back into God's Word. And I want to encourage you to join me as we get into God's Word. And as we let it take root within our lives, as we begin to experience the power of forgiveness and give it to other people. In fact, we find it in the Word of God and in the New Testament, over 140 times it says to forgive over and over and over. It means to let go of the anger and be set free through forgiveness. Forgiveness leaves the offense behind and cancels the debt of that person really owing anything to us. And we see this all over in the scriptures. For example, in Matthew 6:15, we see the parables that Jesus taught. And if we want to be forgiven, we've got to forgive others. And then you go over to, for example, Hebrews 12:15. It speaks of don't let a root of bitterness get in there because many are defiled. And you go over to James 3:11-14. And we see further what the Lord is trying to tell us at this time when he says, does a spring pour forth from the same opening, both fresh and salt water? And then he goes on and he says, but if you have bitter jealousy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast and be false to the truth. This is not the wisdom that comes down from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, and demonic. For where jealousy and selfish ambition exist, there will be disorder and every vile practice. But the wisdom from above is to first pure, then peaceable, gentle, open to reason, full of mercy and good fruits, impartial and sincere. And a harvest of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. In order to do that, we have to forgive. We have to forgive. And actually, what I was doing was reading to you from James 3:14-18. So specific. And somehow we spiritualize or take our selfish ambitions and make them sound somehow religious. We need to get back to basics on what Jesus said. Because like waves lapping at a shore, generations of abuse leads to one generation after another. They tend to follow each other. You go back through the generation, and you can see that people just hold on to things, and they teach their children to hold on to things. And this, and as they get older, they become more and more bitter rather than better. And that's going to be your fate. That's going to be my fate if I don't start letting things go as they come along. As soon as that offense takes place, I've got to pray, Lord, how do I respond to that? Yes. Frequently, for the sake and love of the offender, I have to go to speak to him on a one-to-one basis. I have to point it out. Other times, I'm just going to go to God, and so many times I've done that, I've talked to him, and he's actually dealt with the other person. But if we don't do that, each generation will be trapping the next in an emotional bond of bitterness and anger and unforgiveness. And as a result, untold thousands who have let unforgiveness plague their lives walk around angry at their parents or someone else who's mistreated them in their past. Their lives are confused, their emotions are crushed, and their ability to help others who are in need destroyed. And in fact, God has a tendency to let the Holy Spirit bring into our lives people who have like personalities to those that we haven't forgiven. And it keeps happening over and over and over until we let the Holy Spirit take us through our past, grant us the healing that we need, our inner hurts, so we can forgive those. So you may be encountering one boss after another as you go from job to job that all have tendencies, like the boss you didn't forgive. You might have father figures in your life because you didn't forgive your father, and they show these different things that just kind of set you off. Recognize it and let forgiveness begin to take place. As we read the scriptures, we're introduced to individuals like Joseph in Genesis chapter 37 through 50. Joseph, and you're probably familiar with the story, was grossly mistreated by his brothers. He was thrown in a pit, sold into slavery, and he could have become so bitter all the way along, but he didn't. He sought God. And then, finally, he thought he'd found his niche in life, and he was going to be the servant there of Potiphar. And what happened? Potiphar's wife lies about him. He's thrown into prison, and things are going from bad to worse. He could have become so bitter. But he ended up as a trustee. He kept his spirit free so that when God gave him dreams, he could interpret them. And then when God gave Pharaoh a dream, Joseph could hear from God and interpret that, and he became number two in the country. And what do we see happen? Well, Joseph refused to be a victim. He saw himself as a victor. He was not going to be a victim of unforgiveness and bitterness. And so as a result, when he became leader of Egypt, and his brothers were there, he had an opportunity to get even with them. But we see in Genesis chapter 50, verses 20 and 21, "You intended to harm me, but God intended for good to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. So then don't be afraid. I will provide for you and your children, and be assured," reassured them and spoke kindly to them. Well, how did this happen? Because we can go all the way back to Genesis 39, verse 2, and we can see the Lord was with Joseph. Well, the fact of the matter is, the Lord is with us also. God so loved the world, the whole cosmos, you and me, and all, that he sent his only begotten Son, that whoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. Now, you may have a head trip. You may have a form of religion. You may know the Bible from front to back. But when you're given those opportunities, those daily little tests of whether this is going to happen and that's going to happen to you, and it's going to make you bitter, it's going to make you better, well, how are you responding? To him or her, knoweth to do good and doeth it not. Scripture tells us it's a sin. We know what we need to do. It means we need to rise above the flesh. Oh, frequently I have to say, Lord, help me to love this person, Lord, that seems so unlovable. I'll try to do good for them, and they just interpret it negative, and they come back, and they're vicious, and they're angry, and God, it just happens over and over and over. So I have to forgive over and over and over. And to get right honest, I think there's many times they have to forgive me over and over and over, lest a root of bitterness gets in there, and then it defies many. Take a look at that again. Read that later yourself at Hebrews chapter 12, verse 15. Don't let the sun go down on your anger. Each day forgive, forgive, forgive. It may sound, oh, disciples came to Jesus. Peter did, Lord, how many times do I have to forgive this person? Jesus said, 70 times 7. And the number 7 is infinite. It's like indefinite, infinite. Go on and on and on. Continue to keep forgiving, forgiving, forgiving. And a big indication that I haven't forgiven is when I start feeling this anger inside of me. When that person will say something, they just set me off. And it may not be that bad, but it's an indication that I've just let it build and build and build. I might have in my mind said I'd forgiven them, but I hadn't totally forgiven them. I'm still holding this in the past. Forgiveness means wiping the slate clean. It means being able to love the unlovable. Forgive those that aren't even asking for forgiveness. I need to let the Lord do that in my life. It's Christ's forgiveness, which is extended to each and every one of us. And makes us possible to forgive others who've mistreated us. As a result, the power of forgiveness that Jesus provides releases us It releases us from the power of bitterness that locks us into being victims of the past. You and I can be victims of the past so easily. Maybe a teacher said stuff in the past and you still remember it. A person you really cared about, you really loved, they'd say things to you. You just can't, it's so easy to keep this stuff inside. It's the blood of Jesus Christ that cleanses me from all sin. I have to just, in order to be cleansed, the Holy Spirit will wake me up 5:30, 6 in the morning, put me out, just walk in the streets and praying, then driving me into God's Word and experiencing this freedom of being able to just forgive, frees me to be able to live for the future. It enables me to be able to hear when God wants to speak, because Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice, they know me and they follow me. Can we hear His voice at this particular time? As we choose to release the past and forgive, we in turn allow God to regain control of our life, heal our emotions, and grant us forgiveness. It's that certainty of this forgiveness that gives us the motivation to forgive others. Paul put it this way, and you find that in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 32. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave us. Think about it for a moment. And apply that to particular situations, individuals, things that may have happened in the past. It's hard to be kind to those that keep abusing and misusing you. Speak the truth and love to them, but try to continue to keep showing compassion and free them. So he says, be kind and compassionate to one another. In order to be able to do that, we've got to forgive each other. And how can we forgive each other? Just as in Christ, God forgave us. In Luke chapter 16, verses 11 to 32, we have the story of the prodigal son. Now, most individuals, when they hear this story, think of the prodigal son. They think of the father. They think about how that prodigal son went and squandered his inheritance, how he ended up in a pig pen, how he saw that he was going nowhere, and he returned home, and the father graciously forgave him. But they don't go on and read the rest of the story. There's a whole other part of that story that so many people forget. There is an elder brother. There's this older brother. He probably was an elder in the church. He probably was very religious, or thought he was. And then he sees the father butchering the fatted calf that they'd save for a special occasion. Sees the father lavishing love upon this son who squandered that inheritance and just did all this sinful stuff. And here, the older brother, he tried to live a righteous lifestyle, and he was getting, he was just kind of there, and he's seeing this young man, this prodigal son, totally rewarded. So as a result, now, the older brother, he doesn't go to the feast that's being thrown, and he resides instead in the pig pen of resentment, anger, and bitterness. And there sits a lot of good religious folks. That's why a lot of people, particularly young people growing up today, looking at those that have been in the church for years, can't really get into the Jesus stuff because they don't see Jesus living in His people. They see a whole lot of older brothers that cannot, and sisters, that cannot come to the feast, that can't come and celebrate, that look the other way when they see the prodigal sons and daughters out there in the form of homeless people, maybe on a street corner. See them out there maybe passing out, laying on the sidewalk, and then disgust they keep walking on because they say they got what they deserved. And as a result, they're bitter, angry, religious people. And no wonder the world can't see the good news, the gospel. No wonder when it's invited to the feast, they don't want to come to the feast because all they can see is angry, bitter, religious people. May God have mercy upon us that He might help us to love. Oh, in the last 50 years of taking in prodigal sons, prodigal daughters, and putting confidence in them and training, many have disappointed me. I have to let it go. I got to look to God. I've got to trust Him to continue to speak to them. And they'll frequently come back. They'll start all over. But I can't let myself become that old self-righteous brother. And if we're going to be free to forgive those who've hurt us in the past, we have to come to Jesus. The older brother couldn't do that. His bitter, unforgiving attitude toward the younger brother kept him from enjoying the feast his father had given. N.T. Wright, in his book, Evil and the Justice of God, explains how it is the power of forgiveness. He says, the old phrase for that is dog in the manger. That's someone who isn't enjoying the feast and is determined to prevent anybody else from enjoying it either. When we offer genuine forgiveness to someone else, we're no longer conditioned by the evil they have done to us, even if they refuse to accept this forgiveness and so continue in a state of enmity. So when God offers genuine forgiveness to a sinful creature, she's no longer conditioned by the evil they've done, even if they refuse to accept his forgiveness. It's the power of forgiveness that takes us from being victims of the past to and makes us victors of the present as we move into the future. When this happens, we discover because of Christ's forgiveness and his justification, our emotional well-being is not dependent on the response of the offender. We're free to become agents of love. And as agents of love, we're free from the tyranny of self and we're made a creative force of good in a hurting world. That means that somebody that's hurt me in the past, I might say, I'm sorry, and they say, I'm tired of hearing you say you're sorry. You just say that all over. You keep doing the same stuff over and over. Well, we try not to do that. Or you try to do a good gesture. You try to do a kind act. Well, what'd you do this for? You know, their response should not keep me from forgiving them. Just as God's response to often my attitudes and my actions and my repetitive sinful action, he continues to love me and forgive me through Christ. That's why it's so important that we believe. Don't just have a head trip, but a heart and letting it flow from our heart. And sometimes the longest distance in life is the 18 inches from the head to the heart. Again, to her and him, know to do good and doeth it not, it's a sin. People will tell you, it just doesn't make any sense. You got to be practical. That don't make sense. No, it doesn't often forgive people that have really hurt us, but how we need to forgive them. And we also need to be able to forgive ourselves. There's things that you might have done that have really hurt family members. Crazy stuff you've done. Like the prodigal son, you drank up the inheritance. You messed around out there. People got hurt as a result of your actions. The Father's standing by, ready to forgive you. You've got to forgive yourself. And stop looking at that bitter older brother who's living in his self-righteousness rather than the forgiveness that Christ provides. Know that he loves you. Know that he's forgiven you. Know that he's come to set you free at this particular time. And it's Christ's forgiveness enables us to be agents of love and forgive others. Many choose, though, to bury their anger. They keep it inside, fearing it. If they dare to go there, they're going to become a raging fire burning out of control. Yet anger must go somewhere. As a result, it may seep into our daily environment, like illegally dumped toxic waste, revealing itself in depression, substance abuse, promiscuity, or dreams of wild revenge. What do we do with that anger? Well, what's going to happen is that if we don't do something with it, homes are going to be torn apart, friendships destroyed, a church and a ministry rendered unproductive and effective. Remember, the Bible tells us that God's forgiveness of our sins compels us to forgive those who sin against us. Jesus expressed this fact in the Lord's Prayer when he said in Matthew 6:12, forgive us our trespasses so we can forgive those who trespass against us. So it's very basic. We have to come to God and be honest to God and say, God, I don't have it within me. I cannot forgive this person. But Lord, I know that the same way you can forgive me, you can give me the power to forgive them. And then begin to see them as children of God. Begin to see them. This time, it's much easier to forgive our offender when we see that they too are broken people, victims of their past. Jesus, recognizing this, was able to bridge that whole gap between creeds, what he taught, and deeds, what he did, when he's hanging on that cross and he said, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they do. Or another translation says, Father, forgive them, yes, for they don't know how they're doing it, what they're doing. Luke 23:34. Yes, God gives us the power. We find ourselves like Jesus hanging on the cross, people ridiculing us, rejecting us, treating us so badly, to experience the power of forgiveness. Jesus did it. If Jesus had come down off that cross and used the power that's his as the Son of God and wiped out those who were doing that to him, you and I would have no hope right now. But he stayed on the cross. He died totally surrendering himself to the Father. And he rose from the dead. Right now, trust God. Let's ask God to help us to be kind, compassionate, and forgiving to those that continue to do harm to us. Let's let our light so shine before men and women, they may see our good works and glorify our fathers in heaven. And when you do that, the person who keeps doing this to you is going to get more and more angry. They're going to get so angry, and they may start treating even worse than they did before. Because what they're doing is they're seeing their actions, and they don't know how to deal with their actions. If they would only fall on their knees and say, Father, forgive me, Jesus would quickly forgive them also. So continue to trust God. Continue to pray, whether it's for that husband or that wife or that son or that daughter, that parent, that neighbor, that boss, whoever it may be. Continue to pray for them. And let's get into God's Word. We must never forget that we are encountering an offender because we love them and we want to see restore a relationship, not to seek revenge. As indicated earlier, we are justified by Christ, and our emotional well-being is not dependent on their response. This means that we are free to forgive and let the love of Christ flow through us in the same way it's flowed through Christ who died on the cross for us, that we can be set free. We may have been deeply hurt in the past, but we can't change the past. What we can do is change our perception of it and its feelings, which enslave us in the past. That's why we need to start all over again and respond in a positive way to the invitation that Jesus gives in Matthew 11:28, when he says, come unto me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. When I don't cast my burdens on Christ and unforgiveness lives in my life, I'm not able to experience God's blessings in the present. Unforgiveness keeps me from experiencing the wonders of God's creation. It keeps me from living in the now and seeing that squirrel run up that tree, that rabbit over here, hearing those birds moving in the midst of God's creation. When unforgiveness is there, it fills me full of self, and there's no room for God. And when there's no room for God, there's no room for other people. Bitterness and unforgiveness can drive me into self-centered spirituality that doesn't include the needs of others. That's why I must daily allow the Lord to drive bitterness and forgiveness out of my life by spending time alone with the Lord in prayer and in the Word of God. I believe that people grow old not because of a hardening of the arteries, but because of a hardening of the heart. Time and hopelessness wear us down as we travel down the journey of life. Yet I've learned that the power of forgiveness keeps my heart of love from hardening. And that's why in 2 Corinthians 4:6 we read, we do not lose heart, though outwardly we're wasting away, yet inwardly we're being renewed day by day. So my body may be wasting away. I might have trouble remembering things like as much as I did in the past, but I can depend on the Holy Spirit to bring all things to remembrance. I may not feel the physical strength of my body, but I can depend upon God for the strength to do the things he's called me to do. And I can declare, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I just have to continue to forgive and not get it held back. Emotional healing begins when we let the power of forgiveness flow as we follow Jesus, when we become more and more like him. And as this happens, we begin to forgive as he forgave. You see that in Colossians 3:13. Our complete emotional healing takes on his personality, traits, actions, and reactions to events. Our lives are modeled after Jesus Christ as he becomes the focal point of our emotions and actions. For this to happen, it's absolutely essential, again, that we pray without ceasing and daily study the Word of God and the wonders of his creation. Our past hurts do no longer have to define our future. We don't have to keep living in those hurts of the past. To forgive and move forward means to move into the bright new future that God has for us. We may have been hurt by parents, friends, or strangers, but we're now given the opportunity through the grace of God to be set free by forgiving them. It may seem like the hardest thing we've ever had to do, but it's also necessary. We don't have to let the power of forgiveness go by the wayside. We can begin to experience it first through Christ's forgiveness to us and then extend it to others. It's the power of forgiveness that Jesus provides through our lives today as we forgive those who have harmed us. This is the day we can be set free from the ongoing struggle of living with anger, bitterness, and revenge that comes from a spirit of unforgiveness. Let's repent of those sins now and tell God at this moment we're forgiving those who have hurt us and receive Christ's forgiveness. And Lord, that's what we want to do at this moment. We ask you, Almighty God, in the name of Jesus, to forgive us for our sins. We come to you in Jesus' name. Thank you, Jesus, for dying on that cross and forgiving us for our sins. And Lord, now we just want to forgive others. We want the power of forgiveness to work in our lives and through our lives now in the name of Jesus. Being set free through your forgiveness, Christ, and freeing others, we move into the future. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
As Reverend Larry Rice and the staff of NLEC ask Jesus Christ to strengthen them through the power of the Holy Spirit, you also can do the same. If you've never committed your life to Jesus Christ, you can do that now. Just ask him to forgive you for all of your sins and to be your Lord and Savior.